Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High. Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord, mercifully receive the prayers of your people who call upon you, and grant that they may know and understand what things they ought to do, and also may have the grace and power faithfully to accomplish them. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the first lesson.
First lesson is from Isaiah. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there until they have watered the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall burst into song, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress. Instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall be to the Lord for a memorial, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. The psalm for today is Psalm 65. We will read it responsibly by half verse. You are to be praised, O God, in Zion.
To you shall vows be performed in Jerusalem.
To you that hear prayer shall all flesh come.
Because of their transgressions.
Our sins are stronger than we are.
But you blot them out.
Happy are they whom you choose and draw to your courts to dwell there.
They will be satisfied by the beauty of your house, by the holiness of your temple.
Awesome things will you show us in your righteousness, O God of our salvation.
O hope of all the lands of the earth, and of the seas that are far away.
You make fast the mountains by your power.
They are heard about you.
You still the roaring of the seas.
The roaring of your waves is the clamor of the peoples.
Those who dwell at the ends of the earth will tremble at your marvelous signs.
You make the dawn and the dust to sing for joy.
You visit the earth and water it abundantly. You make it very plenteous.
The river of God is full of water.
You prepare the grain.
So you provide the river.
You drench the furrows and smooth out the ridges.
With heavy rain, you soften the ground and bless its increase.
You crown the year with your goodness.
And your paths overflow with plenty.
May the fields fields of the wilderness be rich for grazing.
And the fields be clothed with joy.
May the meadows cover themselves with flocks and the valleys cloak themselves with grain.
Let them shout for joy and sing.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and of death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and to deal with sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, so that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh. You are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also, through his Spirit that dwells in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus went out and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil, and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts always be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Good morning. So, my husband and I, when we were dating, we lived in upstate New York. And it came time to go together for a vacation. And he decided that we'd go on the typical family vacation, which was to go to a cabin in the Adirondacks. And by cabin, I mean a log cabin, and it had no electricity, an outhouse, and you had to go up the street with a bucket to pour water, to get water. This was not my idea of vacation, because my husband was an upstater and I'm a downstater, which meant I was brought up in the city. And so it kind of went like that until I finally said, no, we're not doing that. It's not a vacation. We're going to go to the shore. Pick a shore. Jersey Shore, Connecticut, Long Island. And we finally wound up at Cape Cod. We wanted to camp at Cape Cod, but at that point I had decided that the only way I would look at camping is with a Holiday Inn that had no pool. And so we went back and forth like this for a while, but eventually he got acclimated to the fact that for me a vacation meant going to the shore. And then we moved to Ohio. And of course we were not gonna go to Cape Cod. And of course there were those mountains in Kentucky. We could go back to camping again. And I said, no. We can camp on the weekends. When it comes to vacation, it should be like Sabbath. I don't consider hauling water Sabbath. So we decided way back when to go to Hilton Head Island. And this was before it was discovered by everybody else in Ohio. And so it became the thing. And the wonder of it all is that my husband became a convert
the going to the beach, going to the sea and to the shore. He became really, really a convert. And he would start planning for it, and he would have his list of all the things that he was going to do. I called it the invasion of Hilton Head. And as my daughter grew up, she got into it with her father about they basically would come up with their list of everything they would do every day. And they would look at mom in the morning and say, look at all the things we've planned. And I'd go, no, I'm going out to the beach because here is vacation for me. Under an umbrella with the beach, a book, and a bar somewhere close. And they used to call it the three B's. They still do. I'd go, have at it, have fun. I am just going to have Sabbath time at the beach. Quiet, smelling the salt air, listening to the waves and the birds, and just enjoying it totally. And I would come home rested. And then my daughter gets married, and she marries a young man from the west side of Cincinnati, and his family always went camping in the Kentucky mountains. Of course, for them, it actually was a camp with electric and indoor plumbing, so I considered that a major improvement. And eventually she said to him, dear, I think one year we need to go with mom and dad to Hilton Head. You've never really been to the beach. And he became a convert, a real convert. As a matter of fact, he starts planning for the Hilton Head trip in January. And he will call me up and go, okay, I've looked at all these condos. Look at where they are. And should we take this? And he gets really into it. But the thing that drove my daughter crazy is that he's a convert to me. He believes in the book, the beach, and the bar. He's very happy going, have fun, dear. Whatever you plan for today, I'm going to be out with your mom on the beach. And pretty soon the two boys, the two grandchildren, we're watching them play on the beach. And of course, what's been happening is a big discussion about, are we going to go, or are we not going to go this year to Hilton Head? And I'm like, no. And I'm struggling with it because I understand that pull. Because for me, this is that week of true Sabbath. This is the week where I just hit back and take some time to think. And the thought that, well, I might have to wait another year for this has been particularly disturbing. And so imagine when I opened up for the gospel for this week, and where is Jesus? He is at the beach on the Sea of Galilee. And I went, Jesus even decides and needs that he needs to go on vacation. And Jesus does this pretty often, by the way. It's not a particular thing just for this gospel. He regularly takes some time to go off somewhere to be by himself. But the fact that the gospel today opens with Jesus at the sea, at the beach, is a statement of, well, he needed a vacation, a Sabbath. As a matter of fact, it is the day of the Sabbath. And, one of the things that happens is last week's gospel ended with, my yoke is easy. And the yoke that the law has put on you is heavy. And then we flash forward to Jesus at the beach, at the sea, and he's going out on a boat. There's a reason why he has decided to take this quiet time, and that is what happened in chapter 12, which you don't get to hear, because it's a single day of the Sabbath, and this is what Jesus went through. I had to write it all down so I remember it all. So it's pretty exhausting. It begins, chapter 12, with Jesus and the disciples running through the grain fields on the Sabbath. And they get in trouble with the Pharisees because they are picking the grain on the Sabbath, and that is against the Sabbath law because that is work. And Jesus gets into an argument with them because they're hungry and they haven't eaten. And a whole debate begins. And that debate continues because Jesus then says, "And what's your problem? I am the Lord of the Sabbath." And he reminds them why God made the Sabbath in the first place, at which point they get really angry at him. And so he heads to a synagogue in order to talk to some folks, and there he comes upon a man with a withered hand, and he heals it. And he gets into even more trouble because now not only has he eaten on the Sabbath, he has healed on the Sabbath. And Jesus starts to talk to them about what it means to have Sabbath, and they get very angry and they conspire to destroy him. So Jesus decides it's a good idea to move to a different place. And the crowds keep following him, and the crowds keep asking him to cure, because they see him doing this, even if it is the Sabbath. And then somebody brings a demon or demoniac to him for healing. And Jesus then begins teaching the crowds about what is happening with this, the possession by a spirit. And he again attacks the religious leaders, particularly the Pharisees, about, you know, healing on the Sabbath. And they say, "You are not healing by the Lord, you are healing by Beelzebub, you are the devil." And so Jesus, seeing that they're rallying up the crowd that he is healing for the devil, decides he better move on. And as he does this, he calls them a brood of vipers. So he's moving on again. And this healing and teaching and debating and getting in trouble continues for a whole bunch of verses in chapter 12 until Jesus' mother and family arrive. And they are trying to get his attention. And one of the disciples says, "Your mother and brothers and family are here." And Jesus said, "Well, who is my mother? Who is my family?" And his family gets a little upset by that. And so at this point, he's in Galilee, and he realizes it's getting towards the end of the Sabbath, and he's tired, and people are conspiring against him, and the crowds are pushing in on him, and he heads straight to the Sea of Galilee. And so these little respites that Jesus has are really important. And what he does at the end is he has a respite or Sabbath time on the Sabbath as God had intended it to be, the quiet time. You see, what he set up here from the end of chapter 11 is this issue about the law having precedence over the grace of God. And he uses the Sabbath as his lesson for this, the examples of this, that you are not allowed to eat if you're hungry. You are not allowed to do anything, even if it is to help someone. And he yells at the Pharisees, "If one of your animals fell into a pit, would you not go and rescue it?" And what he is teaching here is that the Sabbath was made for us, not us for the Sabbath. That the law of the Sabbath and the law as a whole had become a way of burdening the people. They could never actually enjoy Sabbath because they were always afraid. And God said, "Well, we need to have rest. It's a gift of grace." And so Jesus emulates that, and he goes and takes some Sabbath time. And then the crowds press upon him, and he goes out into a boat. And that's when he starts talking about the sower. Now, if this is in the context of all the things that have happened with the Sabbath, with the law, and what it means to have God's grace, And, you know, normally, and I have done this, I have preached this, we tend not to think about why Jesus is sitting at the beach. Because otherwise, if you didn't know what was going on in chapter 12, it would have been, hi, my yoke is light, and now I'm at the beach. Why? Where did that come from? And so we have a tendency to ignore it and go straight to the parable. But the parable he tells is to the people who have seen all of these arguments that he has had about the Sabbath, about the fact that the Sabbath is part of the law and is part of God's grace. See, we look and we preach very often on how when the sower sows the seeds, it should fall on fertile ground. Well, yeah, it should, okay? And, you know, that's what we preach about. But in reality, there's this whole thing about the sower that we so often don't talk about. Because you see, this is a parable not only about fertile soil, it's a parable about the abundant sower or the crazy sower. Because even I, the city child, goes, nobody sows seeds like that. Nobody just throws them willy-nilly all over the place. I used to watch my father with his little garden carefully plant every seed because they were precious. And why does God just willy-nilly do that? The God of creation, the God who cares about all of creation, suddenly throws seeds over, just tosses them out. And I got to thinking about that, and that sowing is really interesting because what Jesus is talking about here is that God is sowing grace. God is sowing love. God is the epitome of abundance. By being so abundant and so, in some ways, careless about all the seeds that he throws, he's saying, I am not the God of scarcity. I am the God of abundant love, abundant grace. I don't just want to throw seed on the fertile ground. I want to throw the seed in the places that might someday be fertile. The places where nobody thinks seed can possibly. The people who believe they can never be fertile ground. God is throwing seeds out there, seeds of grace. God says, my grace is abundant everywhere. Just because you're the fertile one and your heart is open doesn't mean that that grace and that love shouldn't be shared abundantly. And I call you fertile people. Guess what? You need to be as abundant in love as I am. Though a number of years ago when I was preaching on this, my geology professor was in the congregation, and he said, well, you know, sometimes seeds do actually sprout in the midst of rocks and the strange places, because they do. Maybe we should think more about the fact that we shouldn't just assume that a seed can't grow wherever it lands. And I thought, yep, that's true. You see, God gives us grace, and God says, it's everywhere. You don't have to look for it even. I'm just throwing it out there at you. And that's the point about grace for the Sabbath, and why Jesus takes it all the time, is because it's a gift to us. It's a gift to put away all of the craziness, all of the insanity, and to have some quiet time. To take the troubles and all the things that make us anxious and to rest in God. And when we rest in God, the seeds that God has sowed come to be fertilized. They come to sprout. When I was in seminary, and when you start on your journey, they make you repeat time after time after time your call. The moment when you heard God and said, yes, God, here I am, call. What was that moment like? And people ask me about this, and I try and explain it, but it's so hard to explain. There is that moment when you know. And of every year, a couple of times a month, they would say, it's time to talk about our call. How are you called? And I complained to the dean once, and I said, you know, I can hear this in my sleep. And he said, we're making you repeat this so you don't forget why you were called. You don't forget who called you. And mostly, you don't forget how you felt when you heard God call. And I can tell you for absolute certainty that as I heard everybody else's calls, my own included, none of them happened in the Walmart. None of them happened in the cereal aisle at Kroger. None of them happened out on the road listening to tunes or a book from Audible. They always happen in the quiet, in the Sabbath time. That's when that seed that God has sown and thrown out there has the power to take root. It's what Jesus is talking about today. Let it take root. Clear your mind of all the things. And it is hard. You know, the bishop always says to us when he has a meeting with us, so how's keeping the Sabbath going? And I would go, not so good. And finally, the last time I said, so Bishop, how's it working for you? And he said, yeah, it's really tough. It is tough. But God is abundant in grace and in patience. And so what I say to you today is, just because you think that the soil that you have in your life is not perfect for sprouting seeds, God says, doesn't matter. I love you anyway. I love the person who has the hard heart of stone. I love the person who basically is the thistle. I love the person who's been trampled down. I send you my grace. I send you my love. It doesn't matter. Be still and know that I am your God, and I am a God of abundance and love. And those are the things that are the most important to us to remember, because now we are in the time where, well, we're taking a kind of enforced sabbatical. But to remember that in that silence, God is always calling to us and always saying, I am with you. I am the God of abundance. You will never be scarce of my love, for you are mine and you are my creation. I will always be sowing love. Amen.
Seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to
Prayers of the People are according to Form 5, found on page 389 in the Book of Common Prayer. In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love and be found without fault at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, for Thomas, Kenneth, and Nettie, our own bishops, for all bishops and other ministers, and for all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease, and that all may be one as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mission of the Church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who do not yet believe, and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the gospel, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in positions of public trust, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who live and work in this community, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For a blessing upon all human labor, and for the right use of the riches of creation, that the world may be free from poverty, famine, and disaster, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this congregation, for those who are present, for those who are watching at a distance, and for those who are absent, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart and show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our enemies and those who wish us harm, and for all whom we have injured or offended, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For ourselves, for the forgiveness of our sins, and for the grace of the Holy Spirit to amend our lives, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being free from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your Church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord our God.
Let us say together the spiritual communion prayer. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you in my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite me wholly to you, never permit. prayers for this parish family. Strengthen the faithful, arouse the uncaring, and restore the penitent. Grant us all things necessary for our common life, and bring us all to be of one heart and mind within your holy church. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Good morning again. I hope you are all staying cool with this heat wave, and hopefully we'll get to see each other soon in real time. I'm going to do some extra blessings for birthdays this for July, and I think for the months of April and May, I think we missed those. So I'm going to do a little catch-up. So, for birthdays, for those of you who have missed March, April, May, or didn't catch any of the others, here we go. Lord, we give you thanks for their lives and their ministries among us. We give you thanks for the joy in their lives that they have had in this past year, for the strength that you have given them to come through this year in your faith and in your love. And we ask that you send them joy and faith and love and strength and wonder and a sense of awe of your creation for the year ahead. We ask your blessings upon this life and those who share it with them. In your name we ask and pray. Amen. Happy birthday to everyone. And for the anniversaries that we missed, and if you want to celebrate it again for June and July, join right in. A little extra prayer never hurts. Lord, we give you thanks for the couples and the partners among us, for the lives that they share together, and for how they help each other to be in this world and to support the things that they do. We are grateful that you have given us the covenant of marriage. And we are thankful for the year that they've had. And we ask your blessings for the year ahead. Into the unknown we travel together, for the Lord sent us out two by two. And so we ask you to give them laughter and love and sharing and patience as we move forward into the days to come, that they may come to next year celebrating all the awe and wonder that you have given them. In Jesus' name, we pray and ask. Amen. Happy anniversary. And let's see, are there any other announcements
that might be missing? Vestry on Tuesday.
There is a vestry meeting on Tuesday. And also, just a reminder that, you know, a lot of folks think that somehow the church is closed. But the church goes on. And there are a lot of things to do. So if you're a little bit bored or you need something to serve the Lord with, please feel free to contact any of the vestry, call the church office, email me personally or call me, and I would be delighted to talk to you about the work of the church that needs doing for the days to come, because we are here and we are open. We may not be in the building, but the church triumphant goes on. Amen. And now, before I forget, and so let's have a blessing. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever. And thanks to Phyllis today, I think we need to add in a little hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let's go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.